Thank you. Can people hear me? Yeah, can people hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good evening everyone, and welcome to the Black History season at Camden House. Before I get into the formality, can I have a big round of applause for Kouyate, the performer. So Black History Month is marked throughout the UK, but here in Camden we celebrate the continuous of the long season from October to December with many events including arts, music, cultural activities, talks, storytelling and much more, which is happening across the borough. So this evening we'll see quite a lot of stuff happening, including performance and fashion shows and many other things, and hopefully we'll enjoy those events. So last year's Black History season was held during a turbulent and traumatic period. It followed the murder of George Floyd in the United States and the global outpouring in support. Should I use this one? Okay. Sorry, there's been a bit of change with the microphone. As I was saying, last year's murder of George Floyd's, and we saw sort of outpouring of support across the globe in support of the Black Lives Matter movement. Whilst lots has changed, we still feel like the tragic event itself highlights the racial inequality and injustice that we've seen. Some of that has been covered in the news, some of in the political agenda, but also the disproportionate impact of COVID-19, which played in our front of our eyes. Yes, you know, we've got a long way to go to tackling inequality and social injustice. The Black History season is a great moment for us to reconnect and also to celebrate the contribution and the achievement of Black people and people from Caribbean communities in Camden, in UK and across the globe. I'm proud of Camden Council's commitment to tackle racial injustice. Camden is an anti-racist council. Diversity is our strength, which helps us to understand and appreciate other communities. We're also joined by Leader of Council, Councillor Gould. Do you want to give us a big wave, Georgia? We're also joined by Jenny Rowlands, the Chief Executive of Camden Council. Jenny, do you want to give us a big wave? Thank you. And we're also joined by our Mayor of Camden, Councillor Sabrina Francis, the first Caribbean Mayor in Camden. Let's give a round of applause for Sabrina. We'll be hearing from Sabrina later around her take on the event. And I think for us, the fact that we've got the Mayor of Camden, we've got the Leader of the Council, we've got the Chief Executive really shows our commitment to cultural diversity and the fact that we want to celebrate our achievements of our communities. And I think here in Camden, we are making change. And to give an example, you know, we have introduced Black curriculum in our schools. Isn't that fantastic? I think it's important that young people must be taught about their history and about their communities. And I think one size fits all isn't good enough anymore in the 21st century, and that's got to change within our education system. I'm proud to also chair the Statue and Memorial Working Group, ensuring that our buildings and our places in Camden represents our diversity in our communities. We recently renamed Cecil Rhodes and Beckford Primary School, and now proudly to Parkview House and West Hamish Primary School. And again, we're correcting the injustice of the past and the hands of few. We will work with our communities to ensure that buildings and street names known to racists who have used their power and their might to inflict pain and atrocity, we say to no to racism and racist in our borough. I'd like to thank our Disproportionality Working Group, the Camden Black Workers Group, and the local community for making this event possible and also their continuous input.
Black History Season is part of coordinated campaign to celebrate all the people who make Camden a diverse, vibrant place for people to live, work, and visit. The new cultural calendar we're rolling out, which embraces and celebrates Asian, African, LGBT plus community and other communities, as a way of valuing our diversity, valuing people who make Camden a very unique place. I'm proud to be part of this cultural celebration this evening. On that note, I have the pleasure of introducing the host for this evening. Give it up for Eddie Nestor MBE.
Thank you very much, Councillor. Distinguished guests, friends, creatives, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very, very much. I've got all sorts of things written down here. I'm going to put them here and say to you that this is one of my first times out since the lockdown, and that step up on here with these trousers was very... It was very difficult. I can't be the only person that's put on some COVID weight. Not helped, I can tell you, by the four glasses of Prosecco and 18 little patties that I've had. So I do it for little things. If I can get out of here without falling over or splitting my trousers, then this will be a good night for me. Listen, welcome. I've been told by Nikki, it is not Black History Month. It is Black History Season. It's a pleasure for me to be here. Many of the people, the dignitaries here, I've met under different circumstances. So it's nice to actually hear Georgia laugh properly. I've never heard her laugh. I've heard her sigh, take deep breaths, all sorts, but I've never actually heard her laugh. And to meet her husband, and I've offered him my commiserations already this evening. Look, these are tough times. They have been tough times. We're not going to pretend. And I'm not going to stand here and not pretend that I've spoken to a whole bunch of black people who say to me, we have to try to take advantage of some guilt that's come from the death of George Floyd. Now, that sounds horrible. I understand that. But it's a cold, hard reality that, in a way, that made people see things that people had been saying for a long time that they hadn't seen before. We were in our house and we could watch that replayed again and again and again. And I don't say that to bring the mood down. I say it so that we can use that as a springboard for inspiration. I come here and I see wonderful pictures. I see absolutely brilliant clothes being modeled there. And I hope this is an opportunity for us to all network and to leave here feeling lifted and feeling inspired so that we have lots more of these events. And it isn't a month or a season. It just is what it is. Thank you. I've come off of Chalk Farm, and I haven't come out of Chalk Farm Station for, and I'm probably, apart from the children, one of the younger people here tonight. I haven't come out of Chalk Farm for years. I was born in Hackney, and I wanted to do something. I was told by a teacher that I should set my sights more realistically, and after that day, I never studied again. But there was a guy, and there was a play, and I wanted to be in it. They were doing a film called Scum, and I wanted to do that. I was always good at speaking. And at that point, I auditioned for the National Youth Theatre of Great Britain. Now, many of you won't know this. National Youth Theatre of Great Britain was just fantastic. As a kid from Hackney, going with my mum, I did the Scottish play. I can still remember time that anticipates my dread exploits. The flighty purpose nears overtook unless the deed go with it. That's how much it meant to me. I learned it and I still remember it today. Out of 3,000 people, I was one of 30 that got in, and it was the first time in my life I knew I was different. I was born in Hackney. I was surrounded by black people. It was just a thing. When I came here, I was the only black person there. It was the first time I went, wow. You know, wow. People were telling me that they were broke and that they were going to go to Argentina for a month. When we're broke, we eat corned beef and we don't even have the oil to fry. It was a different world to me. We studied or we practiced at Haverstock School. I don't know if it's still there. You come out and you turn left. Haverstock School is where we did the National Youth Theatre of Great Britain. And as I said, it was the first time in my life I was different. I was one, the only one in the room. It's happened to me again and again and again and again. But I'm hoping that actually from these types of things, from an acknowledgement from George Floyd, that there will be an acceptance that actually the differences that we all have and the nuances that we have make it a better, fresher and brighter place. And I hope that we can explore that here today. But I need you to show your appreciation for the young people. Well, some of them aren't so young, I must say. But the young people we're going to bring on the stage. Is that a deal? And we can work this and have a good time and I can have more patties and more champagne. Is that all right? Okay, so look. I have a show on the radio and I'm probably the most hated man in London because my show has replaced a show that was there for 27 years in Robert Elms. But I'm here tonight to have some fun with you. Are you ready to have some fun? Right, so ladies and gentlemen, we're going to invite some people up here. You can see, as I say, pictures, models, music. It's a room of inspiration of creatives, and we're going to get some of those people. The theme for this evening is Proud to Be. I don't know if anybody forgot what came after that. I don't know if there was a stutter, but that's what it is. And whatever you are, hopefully you will be proud, and we'll explore that theme tonight. So might I take this opportunity to have our first guests up on the stage, and they are the Camden Black Creatives. Big round of applause, please. Okay, so I'm told this is my chair. You know it's my chair because I put my newspaper on it, rather like deck chairs on holiday, to mark my territory. Right. Oh, jeez, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get up. Right, hello. Nice. Okay. Camden Black Creatives. We'll find out what that's about. Let me start with you. You sat next to me, so you must be incredibly important. Caroline, how are you?
I'm good.
Oh, yeah? Okay. So, let me give you a secret. Last night, I said to Mrs. Nestor that I was coming to do this, should I? And I said I didn't know any of the performers or the artists or the whatever, and she came up with your name. Your picture? She follows you, she has shared your stuff, and she showed it to me, and it is magnificent. What in here is yours?
Oh, God. The lampshades, the art, the fashion, the chair I'm sitting on, the cushions. Yeah. Yeah, the joggers.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can you get up for me just 1 second?
Oh, no.
No, I'm not going to do anything with you. Believe me, it's not you I'm interested in, it's the chair. I just want to show everybody. Look at that. Can you see it? Can everybody see it? I didn't want to sit on that chair, it's just beautiful. Look. It's always the most boring question, but it is the question to ask for somebody like me, to somebody like you. Where's the inspiration come from?
The inspiration behind Camden Black Creators started with me deciding to become an artist in 2019. And I live in the borough of Camden, Bell Science Park, and I wanted to get representation for my work as an artist. It's a complete new world to me because I started off in fashion and I really couldn't find representation. And then I did a project with Camden Live, and some of the designers that took part weren't really happy about the way they were represented. And I just thought, okay, well, we need more representation as black people in the borough. There's a lot of creativity in London for black people, and I don't think that we've been recognized enough. Me being in fashion for over 25 years, and I'm sure the only black designer anyone really knows is probably Oswald Boateng, and there's so many black designers and creatives that don't really get a platform. And for me, living in Camden, I've got three kids, two 25 and 20-year-old. And my kids have to leave the borough to find culture. And I was like, okay, well, that has to change. Let me see what I can do. And so I started working with Camden Council to help us get more representation and visibility, especially visibility on the high streets, being prominent so that other young people can be inspired by what other black people are doing, especially creativity is a really great way of actually showcasing talents and changing narratives and understanding the culture. So yeah, so I got a bunch of creators that I know and formed the group Camden Black Creators.
Fantastic. I mean, quite often you have to call something out. I saw somebody put something on social media the other day, and it was the 100 top architects in the country. And it was like, there wasn't a black person in there. So there were loads of people. And it's a kind of power that's come from a movement.
Yeah.
Introduce us to your fellow collectives.
Yeah, so this is some of our creatives. Wayne Campbell, who is crazily multi-talented. There's nothing this guy doesn't do. From photography to filming to web designing to drumming to illustration, he does it all. And he recently did the photography where he did some photography during the Black Lives Matter protests, and he's got a book which I'm sure he'll talk to you about.
So let me ask you a question, Wayne. I'm going to let you introduce me to everybody. Wayne, I've had a look at your book. I mean, hold it up for us, please. There are lots and lots of pictures in there. From what was a difficult time. Did you go out yourself in the middle of it?
I did. Over a period of a couple of weeks, I went to a number of different demonstrations up and down the country and just took pictures and just captured what was happening. It was a historic moment, and it's the first time I'd seen en masse so many people coming together to kind of lend a voice or support for something that was a terrible time. And I think least we forget, on the day George Floyd died, the morning, there was that incident with Amy Cooper, who attacked Christian Cooper, no relation, in the park.
She didn't attack him.
She said
he attacked her.
Exactly.
Or the dog.
And called the police,
yes.
Saying that she was being attacked by a black man. And the two incidents together, I think, really kind of helped to make people aware of what maybe black people have been screaming about for such a long time. And for me, it flicked a switch in me, and I just needed to go out and do the only thing I could do, was just help to capture it. So I just, armed with my cameras, I just went and I just wanted to just capture everything, black, white, male, female, young, old, just wanted to capture the essence of what was happening. And I put it all together in this book, and I just think that it's stuff like this that just needs to be in every school, in every library, for people to see.
Yeah.
Because there's so many lessons that need to be learned, and that we took from that.
Yeah, time. But it's part of the discussion, isn't it? And that's what's important. If it isn't illustrated, if it isn't in the book, then somebody else can tell a story of what it was like,
sure.
But it's there now.
Sure.
So lovely to meet you. Can you introduce me to the gentleman with my hat on?
Donald Bowe, he's an amazing sculptor. He's got the work at the back there, which is made out of wood, and it's just so beautiful and extremely well created. Donald.
Sculpting. You see, I sit here as somebody who says anybody can do anything, right? But quite a lot of the time, unless you see or hear somebody to do it, you don't think that people do it. How did you come to it?
Sort of a long journey. I mean, the chest of drawers was a bet when I was at college. I hang around with three guys. There's a guy called Dovetail Dave. We're doing a design course. He's a great maker, but he could not design. The other guy was into the saving the planet and eco, and I was like the mad designer. And David went, ooh. And I said, I'll make something from it. So I made the chest of drawers. But we had to have traditional joints. And over the years, I sort of set up my own company. And you sort of survive, you go through different stages, and the last few years I've sort of understanding what I want out of design. And then
your life journey is also the journey through your work, surely?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It's been a very free and open, so like the colour and the shapes is sort of represents what I've sort of travelled and whatever. And it sort of comes out through that. And nature as well. So lockdown for me was, I know there's a lot of things happening that was really bad, but lockdown, for me, gave me time to just throw down ideas. Mm. So I've now set my target of up to at least 20 new pieces by February, if not more. Completely new pieces.
I've got to tell you, when I speak to you, right, it reminds me of a guy from Hackney that I spoke to recently. He's just written a book.
And it feels like if you lot got together, you could do something. Jay Blades.
I know Jay.
You know Jay.
We speak all the time.
Yeah. But he's repairing things, right? You're building things. But they're in the same kind of world, aren't they?
We talk every so often, and we will do something together. Yeah.
He's a very good man. Really. And had an interesting life, too. Lovely to meet you. Who's the lady
and
here for me?
Finally, Alda Sacco. And Alda is a sustainable fashion designer. So she is... Obviously, we're all about sustainability right now, and we are trying to avoid throwaway fashion. And Alda basically upcycles, recycles things that people have thrown away, from fabric to bath mats. She makes it into absolutely beautiful garments, which you'll see.
And we've already talked about Primark at the top end of Camden, haven't we? No. I know, that's like a swear word. I'm sorry. What is it about? Is it a whole lifestyle? So I'm married to a vegan, right? I'm not. Just, as I say, you know, when our children have their first piece of chicken, they're going to hate her for the rest of their life. But it's a whole world, a whole movement that's kind of different. Is it the whole thing that you go for?
Well, yeah. And then for me, it's a learning process. I'm a former costume designer, and that's what I do on the regular basis. But I think the real awakening for me was when I went back home to Senegal. And, you know, looking at the landscape and then just kind of reconnecting with the land and then seeing all of, you know, the waste the fashion industry and the human beings are creating, I thought, well, I've got to do something about it. And that's how Redress Laboratory was born. And it's not about being perfect. It's about doing better.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's what it is, really. And then it's such a tricky, complex sort of model, because being sustainable doesn't mean just being sustainable with the product that you use, the materials that you're looking at. It's also providing and giving to the people that are actually making your clothes a fair income. And that for me is sustainable. So it is a whole model that you got to look at.
But there are an increasing number of people who want to buy into that, aren't they? They want what they buy to have been sourced properly from somebody who's been treated with respect, and products that have been treated properly. That is a growing market, isn't it?
But is it...
Okay, so let me ask you the uncomfortable question. Is it one of those things that only a few people can afford? Camden still has people who have to buy the bowl of 6 oranges for a pound.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a luxury?
It is, but at the same time, it's not about the quantity. I would much rather buying, let's say, a pair of, you know, a beautiful garment that is really well made.
Yes.
And that it would last longer, rather than just having an abundance of clothes that you're just going to discard in a time soon. So it's about quality rather than quantity.
Yeah.
And that's what sustainability is about, really.
Okay.
Make sure that whatever you're buying... you make the decision, you ask yourself a question, do I really need it? And I think if you can answer that question, then you just go for it. And then you make sure that the people that actually made the clothes are decently paid.
That's fantastic. Is there a piece of your work here also?
Yes.
Where?
It's the lady with the breaking heart.
Hello. Okay, so Caroline, what's success look like for a collective of people with a thought about creating things, making things, developing things? What's your hope for the next 12, 18 months?
Oh, God. For CBC, what I really want to do and what we all want to do is change the narrative of what our community looks like, inspire young people to know that there are, you know, people that look like them.
Yeah.
Who can work hard, who can achieve something, and then they too can achieve something, but also change the way other cultures see our culture. And this is what we want to do. Like, for instance, Camden has been extremely supportive of CBC, and we've been able to get, through the help of Camden Council, get a pop-up shop in Hampstead, which will be opening in the next week. So if anyone's in Hampstead High Street, please pop down and see it, and you'll see other creatives work. And just changing that narrative, because a lot of people in Hampstead have never probably ever supported a black business, have never probably bought anything from a black business. So this is what we want to do, is that we do have brands out there that you can also buy into. It's not just us buying into your brand. We need you to buy into our brand to help us be successful as well. So this is what we want to see happen.
Well, we'll be talking about the Black Pound a little later on with Swiss. I've got to say, I wish you the very best of luck. Hopefully everybody here goes and looks and buys and enjoys your products. Thank you very, very much for talking to me today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, that's lovely. We see the pictures over there, you can see it. Hopefully we get a minute and we can walk around. And network is always really important for me at events like this, that we get to say hello, meet people, talk to people. Please excuse my manager, she tell you the event is being live streamed, and also sign is taking place over here with these two lovely ladies who are gonna try and copy what I say. Sorry, I'm a child, come on. For goodness sake. I would like to invite the mayor onto the stage now. Let me give you her thing. Sabrina Francis is Camden's first black female mayor. She's going to come up. She says she doesn't want me to interview her. She wants to give her speech and I should leave her alone. Your wish is my command, Sabrina.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Firstly, I didn't say I wouldn't be interviewed. I just said I had prepared some words. It kind of felt like, as Camden's kind of first black woman to be mayor, I probably should take the time to say what I had to say, really. As Eddie mentioned at the beginning, this year's theme is Proud to Be. So it really got me thinking, like, what is pride? And what do we mean when we use that term? So ever the student, I looked up the definition. So pride is a feeling of deep pleasure or satisfaction derived from one's own achievements, the achievements of those with whom one is closely associated, or from qualities or possessions that are widely admired. So I think if we reflect on that definition, then it's very clear that we as black people have lots to be proud of, not just today, not 1 month a year, but all the time. And I think personally, I'm sort of just about at a point where I can be proud of my achievements. I somehow stand here as the first black woman to be mayor of Camden and the first black person since 1987. And being a black mayor and a local councillor at this particular kind of political moment hasn't been easy, but it has been the honour of my life. And being able to take a role in how Camden shapes its response to Black Lives Matter and makes plans to embed racial justice in all that we do has been hard, but so, so worth it. As Councillor High mentioned, a few weeks ago, we renamed Cecil Rhodes House, and I'm incredibly proud that the only name on a building that was previously named after a racial oppressor is mine. And I am just a black girl from round the corner who somehow is now Camden's first citizen. And the second part of the definition I read talked about taking satisfaction in other people's achievements. And I have to say that that has been one of the true highlights of what has been a very difficult year and a half. So from Daniel Kaluuya's Oscar to Bucky Bakray and her like her BAFTA nominated performance in Rocks, to even like Sancho and Rashford and Saka facing down the racists after the Euros, those high profile stars gave us all something to be proud of. But so too did our community. During COVID, it was often black people that kept the country running in the face of danger. Bus drivers, care home staff, and NHS workers are largely non-white, and they kept on working even as their colleagues were dying at an alarming rate and when they weren't getting the support they needed from the powers that be. We should all be incredibly proud of their strength as they got us as a nation through the hardest times imaginable. And finally, we all know that black people have qualities and possessions that are widely admired. From music to fashion, black culture is culture. Bantu knots, baby hairs, Insta baddies, we invented all of it. Some will try to take things away from us and only recognise our contributions when they have a white gloss or they've been appropriated by a Kardashian. But we know we have much to be proud of. So we should work hard to amplify our business owners, our creatives and our thought leaders so they get the props they deserve in their own right and in their own time. So let's use this year's theme as a springboard, something to remind us of the many things we have to be proud of in the past, but also something to propel us forward so we always have more to be proud of. We are more than our struggle stories, and I can't wait to be sat in that audience in the future, beaming with pride as I get to hear a speech from the 3rd, 4th, and 5th Black Mayor of Camden. So let's make it happen.
So, madam, oh, you're going to, all right. Jesus, just hard to keep getting up and down. Hello.
Hello.
So you've made your speech. You feel better now?
Yeah. Just prepared at all times.
How long have you been mayor?
Since May. So the council year runs from May to May. So I'm nearly halfway through.
And how have you found it?
It's super interesting. Like, you get to meet people and organisations that you wouldn't necessarily know exist. Camden is a bonkersly big borough with lots of organisations doing great stuff. But I think being, like I said, being a black mayor at this moment is hard, and it has kind of has its own sort of like trials and tribulations. I feel like expectations are high. I hold myself to very high standards because I don't really feel like I can live in this shell and be mediocre.
Is it that you think, particularly children, young people, all of them, not just black, what is it that you hope they get from seeing you as mayor?
Just to know that it's possible. So it's like not actually that hard to become a local councillor. you can like get involved in your community. I think it's up to us to find people who are doing great things in their community and sort of like succession plan and like bring them into the family. But I think, yeah, making people know that it's possible. I try to be as visible as I can. Like, my school have invited me back to speak. I do nearly kind of every event I can because I appreciate that I don't look like a normal mayor.
Yeah, I don't know what a normal mayor looks like.
We do know what a normal mayor looks like.
But what does a normal mayor look like?
An old white man.
An old white guy.
Yeah.
Well, you haven't got an ordinary looking leader of the council.
No, we don't. We don't. Like, we are Camden. It feels very Camden to have a woman leader, a female chief exec, and a black mayor. Like, this is just how we roll.
I think that's a great place to leave it. This is how we roll. Mayor of Camden, Sabrina, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to quickly invite Natalie onto the stage. Nats, are you around? Nats, thank you so much. First thing Nat said to me is, that's not the first thing you said to me. How dare I? Nats is going to tell you about a few of the things that she's doing, and then I'm going to talk to you afterwards. Is that all right?
That's perfect.
Thank you very much.
Hi, everyone. I'm Nats from Small Green Shoots. I wore the wrong shoes for this stage. I don't even know how you follow that. That was just bang on, amazing, perfect, and so authentic. So I'm not going to be that good, so I'm just measuring your expectations. I'm Nats from Small Green Shoots. I basically founded, and I'm the CEO of, a youth-led organization that champions excellence in low-income young people. 75% of my cohort just happen to be black. Strange that, isn't it? And we really like inspire them, encourage them, and train them for jobs in the creative sector, because we're such a creative borough. We've got so much regeneration going on, and we want our young people to be the first in line to build careers, not just jobs, careers in the music industry and the entertainment industry. There's loads of opportunities here. We want to be first to get them. So I wanted to just quickly introduce these amazing young people here. Jaden and Jason are part of a new project that we are piloting and we are championing called This Is Not a Conservatoire. Think about that. So many times Black, young, really talented musicians are failed by the traditional classical music system. We are revisiting it, rewriting it. Watch this space. I hope it works. We're investing a lot of time and effort into it. But these two musicians here are... Mike's back. These two musicians here are technically absolutely excellent. There's no doubt. They're right up there. We just need to provide them the avenue to get the recognition that they need. So Jason and Jaden, don't let me down now, please, because I've really, like, overreached. And this amazing young lady here, Elana, is one of our young shoots that works with us. She's an incredible young person. This is her first time performing in a very long time, and she hasn't performed that much at all. So she's really nervous, but she's incredible. I think when I came here, some people were like, okay, what is it gonna be like, ragga? Is it gonna be like some vociferous spoken word? Is it gonna be like calypso? Is it gonna be like rap? Like, we do everything. We're black people, we can do everything, every genre, anything, it's from us. So I hope you enjoy this. She's fantastic. Please make her feel welcome. Elana, Jaden and Jason.
I'm watching the days roll by, and I'm comparing them side by side. Nothing ever seems to change at all, just trapped in a loop of doubt. Will someone ease my brain? 'Cause I just want to feel the rain again on my skin, glistening as the thunderstorm begins. I just want to feel alive again. Ooh. I want to live my life, but it's on pause. When I talk to my friends, it's on course. Eyes can't take much more of this blue light, but there's no escape inside. Will someone ease my brain? 'Cause I just want to feel the rain again on my skin, glistening as the thunderstorm begins. I just want to feel alive again. Oh, and I know there'll come a day when I'll hold your hand again. And though it may seem far away right now, I'll see you soon. I'll wait for you.
Okay, that's lovely, by the way. Well done. Well done. "We're nervous. I was nervous for you." She set you up so much. It was like, you had to do it. I know. And you did. You did. Well done. Sorry, Nats, we're just talking about you. Please take a seat, Nat. The most expensive chair there. Please take a seat. So when we...
Can I just say, proud to be Elena's boss. I'm so proud to be her boss. Proud to be Jaden and Jason's boss. We're all proud to be here.
You're doing now is you're basking in their reflective
glory. Oh, 100.
It's got nothing to do with you.
Absolutely. You weren't
playing and you weren't singing. So leave them alone. Nothing to do with you. Tell me, the one thing I know, right, is that in our school, we had some of the best footballers. We had some of the best singers. But the discipline that goes with natural talent was the barrier, I think now, when I look back, to them achieving all that they could achieve. How much, when people come to you where you find these rough diamonds, is that an issue?
Have you been talking to someone about me or something? Like, do you know this already? Because I'm really hardcore. And like, I feel like, Alana, have you been talking to Eddie about me? No? I suppose, like most people in this room, when I grew up, and it was actually my Irish grandpa that told me this, he said, "You're going to have to be better just to be average." It's one of the first memories I've got of the things that he said. And he didn't say it in a way. He said it to help me. He said, "You're going to have to be better now. You're going to have to be better just to be average." And I have lived by that. And I have exactly the same message to the young people that come to me from Small Green Shoots. They're incredible. They're talented. They're deserving. And I want them to have the same expectations of excellence.
Yeah.
And that takes a lot of discipline and a lot of a kicking and a lot of sometimes grafting praise, but in equal measure scaring the absolute crap out of them.
Yeah, which means that not everybody makes it. So all the people who present don't end up doing what we saw these young people doing today.
Oh no, every single person at Small Green Shoots succeeds. I wouldn't be in the business if that happened.
So
I think it was someone else that said quality over quantity. Yeah, 100%.
So you're able to get the discipline?
100% success rate at Small Green Shoots. I will expect nothing less.
So why are you leaving?
Oh my God. I'm not leaving. Okay. I didn't know you were going to ask me that. I didn't know you knew.
I've been doing this for a little
okay,
while.
Okay, you can't... Eddie, you can't stand here. You can't stay in a position for 10 years talking about there's not enough black leadership and be taking up space. I've been a CEO for 12 years. It's time to let someone else have that glory, that basking in their glory. It's time to let someone else have a go. And I think you've just got to do the right thing. You know when it's the right time to let someone else have that spot. And you can't talk about black leadership and be sitting in a space of power and not pass it up to another black leader. That's not leadership.
Or bring them through. But in terms of where we are and why we're here today, young people in Camden, better now than it was 10 years ago, do you think? It's a question, not a statement.
We still have so many more issues. And I was really interested by your opener when you spoke about, you know, using this. I'm going to just be a little bit more diplomatic and talk about using the zeitgeist, using this moment. I come from the commercial music sector myself, so I'm not a saint. But at the same time, I'm very doggedly, quite ruthlessly ambitious for the young people that work for me. I will use whatever it takes to get them to the top.
Okay, so we're in a moment and it's better to use whatever is coming for that moment. And if young people are sitting here today and they think they have talent in spoken word or singing or playing a musical instrument, is there a word of advice that you have for them?
Yeah, go and find someone else, because I'm more interested in your professional development and being a music industry executive, where you become you grow into a career where you become that person that hires people. That's where Small Green Shoots really is. What you saw was the creative talents of some of the shoots that I'm working with.
Yeah.
But if you think think I'm not training them for to be marketing executives at the same time, you're very wrong. That's exactly what I'm training them to do.
Train them to read the contract small print, yeah?
Absolutely.
Nats, it's a pleasure meeting you. Apparently we're going to do it again soon.
Oh,
lovely,
okay,
lovely to meet you.
Thank
lovely
you.
To talk to you.
Thanks.
Go, Nats. I need one of them stainless steel lift things. Okay, so that's nice. It's nice to see young people, and it isn't, as we know, just about performing. It's about all the other stuff that goes. I often go into schools. Funny enough, I've never been in one in Camden, but I often go to schools and talk to the young people. And one of the things I say to them is, in our school, when I was at school, people who were wearing the best trainers then are wearing the worst trainers now. And it takes a minute, but it does, because lots of the kids want to go in the class and be a fool at the back of the class or whatever. And then you tell them about going on to a program like one of these talent shows. And you say, well, they have to learn the words to a new song every week. They have to learn where the camera is. They have to learn a new outfit. They have to get there on time. They have to wear it. And you start to explain to young people in particular just how challenging it is. I've got an 8-year-old and a 12-year-old. And I really never want to have to say what my parents said to me and what Nat said to her, which is that you have to be twice as good. I don't want to. Maybe I will have to, but I don't want to. Right, so let's get some spoken word. Lewis, where are you? Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for Lewis.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much. Do you know what? Before I start, I think it's very important for us to acknowledge some of the people that helped make things like this happen, because I saw, is it Jonathan? Yeah? You're doing a lot back there. Can we just give him a round of applause? He's doing a lot to pull things together right now, and I think we need to appreciate that. Everyone else that's doing the sound, Nikki, who helped plan the event. Sorry, I feel like I'm doing Eddie's job, but yeah, Nikki, who planned the event, hospitality staff. We need to appreciate it, because you know what I mean? Also, I realized that I like to walk around when I do this, and you got a couple like, so I'm not going to walk around too much, you get what I'm saying? But normally I do like to walk around. So that being said, I've been asked to do some spoken word. Interestingly, it's something that I don't actually do often. I just bring it out when I feel it's necessary. So I put something together yesterday evening, and this morning in the gym I said I have to try and memorize this thing because it's this evening, innit? So that's what's going to happen. So I'm very big though on interaction. So I'm going to name a few people within this piece, and if you know their names, just say their name at the same time as me, yeah? Hopefully it will come together. You have to know a little bit about Black history for that though, but we'll see what happens. So with that being said, let's make a start. Proud to be, proud to see the people of our culture succeed and achieve. Let's celebrate our history, but make some more today. Because you know, when it comes to our people, when we show up, we don't play. Whatever we go through, nothing can stand in our way. So on this journey, let's not be distracted. On this path, we cannot stray. But see, when we're taught about our history, we're often taught about struggle. And it's interesting because what I've noticed is that no matter what cards we're dealt, we take the whole pack and shuffle. And on this journey, we have to stay locked in, treat it like a tunnel, and cause those who held us back to be nothing but puzzled. See now, this month is a great opportunity for us to understand that our greatness never left us. So I think it's important that we acknowledge some of our icons and ancestors. We're channeling their energy to make waves from London to Leicester or become legendary entertainers just like Eddie. Okay, you're switched on. Just like Eddie Nestor. See me, I'm a man that loves Notting Hill Carnival. I can all go on my own. But I'll never forget its great founder, Miss Claudia. We're in the building. Paul Stevenson and Roy Hackett, as well as many others, they saw an injustice and did more than just blow a whistle. They led a true act of resistance with their boycott in Bristol. I love it. Cool. And this is the 34th time that we're celebrating this month due to the forward thinking of a couple of good fellows. So let's appreciate Ansel Wong and Akiaba Adai. Sebo, founders of Black History Month. You don't need to know the thing. Anyway, so that's who founded Black History Month, for those that don't know, Akiaba Adai Sebo. That being said, in our past, we've also had amazing black women who, when they seek change, they go for depth, nothing shallow. So I want to acknowledge the former general, the former secretary for the campaign against racial discrimination, Miss Jocelyn Barrow. Dark as Howell, Frank Critchlow, there's many more that I could name, but in the interest of time, I'm going to bring us up to the present day. We've got amazing young people who can contribute to the music industry in a range of ways. So we thank the whole team at Small Green Shoots and their outgoing leader, Miss Natalie Wade. Switched on. I love it. And not through music, but conversation, the truth hits us like a bass and a treble. I thank Sandra Soteriou for everything she does and for being a necessary rebel. And then, of course, we have to understand that to sustain our progress, we need not just our love, but our money to be making the rounds. So we appreciate Swiss for leading a movement that circulates the Black Pound. So I said at the start, proud to be, proud to see the people of our culture succeed and achieve. And with what I'm seeing today, I truly believe that for future generations, it is our contributions they'll be inspired to read. Thank you very much. I don't know if I still need this.
That's really good. Lewis, well done. Really, really, really well done. Really, congratulations to you. As well as spoken word, you're a motivational speaker. What does that mean? What does a motivation... Don't tell me motivate either, please. How does it work?
I was going to deny the title, to be honest.
What were you going to say? How would you describe yourself?
First of all, I facilitate progress. That's how I'd classify myself. The vehicles I use to facilitate that progress is I run two social enterprises. So one of them, Revolution Hive, our mission is to equip young people for life beyond the classroom. So we go into schools up and down the country. I was in a school in Burnley on Tuesday, Bradford the week before. We're up and down all over. And what we do is we run programs that focus on three main things: personal development, social responsibility, and global citizenship. Because it's important for young people to appreciate that if you're going to be a holistic adult who doesn't just contribute to our society but helps to reform it, you need to be aware of all of those aspects of your development. And then my other social enterprise, 7PK, focuses on giving people from disadvantaged backgrounds more equity within our society. So we do a lot of work in the space of program design, as well as building capacity for other organizations to help with initiatives that revolve around social mobility, as well as equity, diversity, and inclusion. It just so happens, and I've only really started to really embrace this in the last couple of years, that I do have an ability to walk into a room, speak, and not only do people listen, but people feel compelled to operate differently. And now that I embrace the fact that my voice can do that, I'm unapologetic with that. However, my motivation, in my opinion, is a byproduct of the strategy that goes into what I do. And I say strategy for a reason, Eddie, because I think it's so easy, and I've seen this a lot in my career, you know, I was going to say young, but true say it's just cocoa butter and everything there, but young-ish black man, I go into a room, got a little bit of energy. Oh, Lewis, it's your charisma. Don't play with me. It's not just charisma. This is intelligence. This is strategy. Do you get what I'm trying to say? If you're motivated by the end, that's okay. But I'm being real, like, I know what I'm doing. Do you know what I mean? That's not an accident. That student didn't change because it was an accident. That person in that company didn't change because of an accident.
Yeah, but you see, look, I've been around and I hear you. And fantastic. You are a speaker. You have what they call the gift of the gab.
I accept that.
I'm interested, though, in real terms, application for the kid who's struggling to read, who doesn't have access to the internet, as we found with COVID difficulties. How do you apply it to, I don't know, a kid in a school, sorry, young person in a school in Camden? When you go in, what is it you are trying to do, and what do you use as a barometer for success?
Well, for me, I would try and raise their awareness to what's one thing that they can prioritize to kickstart their development. So you mentioned Haverstock School earlier. Right. There's a company that we do a lot of work with in Camden, and they asked us to run their virtual work experience program in summer. So in running that program, they had partnered with Haverstock School, and we were solely working with students from Haverstock. And it was interesting. I always remember one young man, I'll shout him out, Caden, actually. And what I found interesting was you could see he lacked confidence in this virtual work experience. He would never put himself forward to speak. He kind of would wait to be spoken to, and often his answer was, I don't know, which is a common response for the young people you're describing. Their go-to is, I don't know, because they're so concerned about the contribution they're making being of value. So what I picked up
was... the response to an opinion.
Right, that's it. So when I noticed that with him, he was very similar to how I was when I was younger, where he couldn't help but incorporate slang into every sentence. So he made a contribution, and I said, that's really good, you know. I said, like, personally, I'm very comfortable with it, but have you ever thought about how you articulate yourself? And, you know, and then he said, no, not really. So instead of carrying on a conversation with him, I just used my own experience and said, oh, do you know what? When I was younger, I really had to think about my use of slang when I articulate. Then he kind of waited for a break and said to me, how did you do that? Because I want to learn how to do that. Now I've got him. Now this guy emails me like every couple of weeks telling me about, yeah, Luke, I'm updating my CV. Can you look at it? Can you? I'm like, do you know what I mean? So you need one little thing that they can latch onto, like, that's achievable. That is achievable for me. And then we take it from there. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, and that's good. I asked the question and you answered it.
I'm glad.
It's rare in my world. Well done. Listen, I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much, man. I appreciate it. Cheers.
Lewis, ladies and gentlemen. You've got to say, she's already been referenced here. Well, I must say that when I saw her when I walked in, I was like, oh, I was struck by it. I don't know why. I mean, Sandra, can I invite you up here, please, so that I can find out what it is about you. I'm more nervous than you are. So is my mic.
Thank you for the name check, Lewis. I appreciate that. Did not talk about that beforehand, so just so you know.
Okay, so that's a great Camden accent there. It's first thing.
Okay, you want to talk about the accent?
Yeah.
Okay.
I do.
So I'm American. As you can tell, I've got an American accent. I am. My family are originally from Haiti. So I'm Haitian-American.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is that simply the unluckiest place on planet Earth?
America or Haiti? Like, right? How y'all feeling? I don't know.
This is being live streamed and I work for the BBC. I'm not going to give any comment, but needless to say, maybe 46 wasn't as good as people thought in relation to 45. That's the American reference.
Mm-hmm.
And in Haiti, I mean,
yeah.
It's one of those places that's never been taken over, never been conquered.
Yeah.
One of the places where certainly as a kid whose parents are from Dominica, if you wanted to do something to somebody, you would go to Haiti to get it done. But, you know, we'd have enough attempts to raise money. And then I see that image, which is pertinent for today, I think. That image, which reminded everybody who saw it of slavery, of a border force man sitting on a horse, whipping a Haitian. I mean, I know that's not what we're here for, but I live in the real world, right? How did that touch you?
Oh, well, it made me really angry. But it's a reflection of how Black people are treated in America, and I just think it was really... It's kind of like when you see these images, you're like, this is 2021, right? What the hell is going on in 2021 in America that a man on a horse can whip a Haitian migrant? And it just made me angry. So lots of us wrote letters to the president and the vice president. Yeah, I mean, it's difficult for me because I'm so close to it and it just really upsets me so much.
Yeah, but it's not, you know, on one hand, I can say it's not what we're here for.
Yeah.
But the motivation, I think we'd all accept for much of what has happened in the last 18 months has been George Floyd.
Yeah.
George Floyd didn't happen here.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't know. Sabina Nessa happened here. Bieber and Nicole happened here. Sarah Everard happened here.
Absolutely.
There are issues around power. I think it's, you know, it's just worth talking. But everybody's told me you're a bit of a fighter, you, aren't you?
Well, my boss is here. He calls me a disruptor. So I think I'm disrupting some spaces.
Is that right?
Sure.
Is that right? Hey, she's here. The disruptor is here. So tell me about the name change, because it's been quite controversial in, I think, London, about whether or not places should be changed. People have it up as a political thing that mostly is done in Labour boroughs, but Cecil Rhodes. And tell me about your involvement and your feeling about that.
It's about time. Like, the fact that it's just happened now, it still surprises me. But I think that should have happened a really long time ago. The fact that, I mean, one of the stories, I mean, my boss told us this story about a guy who used to walk across, who used to walk past Cecil Rhodes and used to feel really ill every time he walked past that building. And that's a real reflection of people who actually lived in that place. I mean, the fact that, for me, the thing about the names, I think what we found in the beginning were the reasons why those names exist now is because people who look like me were not part of those conversations. So until we get to sit at the table and be part of those conversations, only then can we create change.
I accept that. I accept that. But it is a challenge. The Prime Minister in his keynote speech at Manchester talked about, you know, people who wanted to airbrush history. Winston Churchill, his hero, would never be voted as a leader now on mental health issues, alcohol issues, but he was a person for the time. Gandhi was a hero of mine. When I looked at what he said about Kaffirs, which is his about black people, I was disappointed. How far, before we talk about your fashion, how I think we're in a moment. I think we all accept that. How far do we go then?
Oh, we got to keep going. Someone asked me recently, you know, if things don't change in 3 years, how are you gonna feel? And I said, well, if things don't change in 3 years, it's like climate change. It's even more urgent. We need to do more work. Like, we don't stop here. We're only just scratching the surface of the work that we have to do as a collective. And I think as a collective, we are stronger and louder together. So I want us to be loud and to be bold and to be strong, and for us all to disrupt spaces and stop letting people get away with the stuff they get away with.
Oh dear. Your boss is right then.
Oh, well, yeah, he's pretty right, yeah.
you are a disruptor. Okay, but you're also somebody who deals in fashion.
Yeah.
Look at you.
Yeah, I know.
How would you is that a robe? Is that a... It looks like something that Tyson Fury would be happy to go into the ring in tomorrow night.
You know,
fantastic.
What? That's how I feel when I wear it, actually. Yeah. Yes. So this was created for me by a woman, and she invites you over to her house, and you sit with her for an hour, and you tell her your life story. And then 2 weeks later, she says, it's ready. So this is my life story. It's got the Haitian map on it. It's got... images of my son, my husband, my daughter, they're all kind of embedded into this piece of fabric. So I really love it. And when she gave it to me, I said, oh, you put my picture on the back of it. And I thought, oh, isn't that a bit vain? She said, honey, you black and beautiful. They should see you from the front and the back. So, okay, there you go.
Okay. So, but it's the business that you've started with, the head wraps that we primarily want to celebrate here in Camden, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
How did that come to be?
So a friend of mine, white British, I wear head wraps all the time. I'm Caribbean, so I grew up wearing head wraps. My mother always wore head wraps, and my grandmother always wore head wraps.
No. You grew up wearing tights on your head.
No.
Or a headscarf.
Wait. No, Eddie, let me just tell you. It was actually called a mouchoir.
Okay.
All right. And Creole is called a mouchoir.
Mouchoir.
Mouchoir. So we all wore mouchoirs on our head. That's what we wore.
Okay. So in my house, it was tights.
Okay. All right.
And it was denier. Okay. Right. Okay. Well, it's great, isn't it? Different experiences. That's one of the things we do a lot.
Yeah.
We do to ourselves, expect everybody to have had exactly the same experience. So that's great. Right. So tell me about your mouchoir.
So... So I met a woman who had gone through chemotherapy, and she said, could you please come over and show me how to wear a head wrap? And when I got to her house, she'd lost all her hair to cancer, a very good friend of mine, and she said, I want to wear my head wrap just like yours. And I was thinking, just like mine? I don't know if you could wear it like me. But she said, the reason why I want to wear it up like you wear yours is because I want it to still look like I have hair. And for her, losing her hair was the most devastating thing. And so I wrapped it up for her, and then I met other women who were also having chemotherapy, and I went into the hospital and actually showed other women how to wrap their hair, and that's how my business began. But since starting that business, I'm also an ambassador at a charity called Hello Love. I realized the importance of this material and how we own this, right? And how empowering wearing this material makes us feel. And I wanted all of the women who I wrapped to be a queen with a crown. And so that's our kind of motto for the business.
How do you fancy making a queen tonight?
Yeah, let's do it. I think I found someone. Samantha?
Samantha here. And you're going to do it and carry on talking to me. Because you're clearly multi-talented and can do more than one thing at a time. Let me get a chair ready for Sam.
Should we do it there?
Okay. Samantha? Samantha, you were about to be coronated to rise to the throne. It is interesting that actually, because certainly when I was doing a lot of work with chemo and the like, women much more scared of losing their hair than anything else. It was like the personification and the showing of the cancer. And as my mum would say, a woman here is her beauty. Right, so you're going to start? We've got a mic there for you, I think. Okay. Samantha, hold on. Samantha, hold on, hold on, hold on. Samantha, are you okay? I haven't even spoken to you. We've not met. Hello, I'm Eddie. There you go.
Okay.
There you go. Okay, so, right. So, okay. So, round
the
top.
This is an updo. And it's basically the way that I'm wearing my head wrap.
Right.
Okay, so you put a knot at the top. So head wraps are just basically knots and tucks.
Knots and tucks?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. No, don't worry. I've got that bit. You do the hard work and I'll turn it. There you go.
Perfect.
Sam, have you worn wraps before?
I wear wraps, well, regularly, yeah.
Oh, you're wearing a proper one now, not like what you're used to wearing.
Stop it.
Sorry. This is so naughty side of me.
This is just an updo. It's very, very quick. It literally takes about 30 seconds to wear a head wrap. And it really accentuates the woman's beauty, I think. And it really shows off your face because you can really see a woman's face when she's wearing her head wrap. And you know what? That's what they didn't want back in the days when they wanted to for us to wear our hair covered. So just a little bit of history. When the slaves were taken from Africa, they were stripped of all of that beautiful African print. And they were given these torn t-shirts, and that's what they wore as part of their, they had to wear their hair covered, and that's what they wore, these kind of torn up t-shirts. But you know what, that backfired. Because we still look good in those torn up t-shirts. They weren't expecting that. So even now, lots of people will still wear t-shirts and kind of all kinds of material on their hair, and you still look very, very beautiful. These particular wraps that I have, they come from Nigeria, Kenya, and Zambia. We buy from women. Women cut and sew the fabric here, so it's all about how we support other women, and we sell the fabric here. So that's how we do it.
How you feeling, Sam? Sorry.
I feel great.
You look great. You look great. Do you take it off or does Sam keep it on? There you go. Samantha, thank you very much for being our model. Sandra, disruptor, a pleasure to meet you. An absolute pleasure. Look after yourself. Keep disrupting. Thank you very much. God bless you. Thank you very much. Okay, I'd like to invite the Camden Black Creatives back onto the stage. We're going to get more fashions, more styles for you now. You got a little glimpse at the beginning of tonight's proceedings. So we're going to get a little more now. And I'm going to get off the stage and out of the way, because clearly you don't want to see me.
Okay, hi guys. So we're going to have... a showing of some of our designers. Can we just please say thank you to the models? They've been so patient, sitting here, looking gorgeous. Well done, girls. So we're going to have sort of three designers showing, and the models are going to walk around, and you guys can see the outfits properly when you're ready. The first designer is from Chinawake. So this is made out of all silk, and it's from my collection. This is from Samantha Manda, and this is upcycled and redesigned outerwear. This is from a designer called Samson Saboye, and this is a unisex suit, so for men and women. Another Chinawake dress. And this is Alda Sacco, upcycled wear. And who can move like this? Let me see what I can do right quick. My people were made of moves like this. Boy, fly niggas ain't never flew like this. Pitch black butterfly from the other side. Somebody's style was lost, it wasn't mine. I'm in a small demographic of real ones dealing with all things classic. King's fabric, linen and silk from a home on a side. Home honey and milk, the ones who built it from the mud. Soul to sand, the black man. The world had a skin of his hand. Popped in a sock when I shine beyond stellar fella. Kwame and Crumb, Mandela, leader, true teller. The ain't well blood. My pen signs in New York Times bestseller. When I move, y'all move in my way. Beat the energy, I generate. How to never move weak, I demonstrate. Celebrating my peeps when I innovate. For my dimes and demons, weighing odds and evens. To the non-believers, vagabonds and heathens, achievers. We ain't satisfied with dreaming. Long as I'm still breathing, watch how I move. Thank you guys very much. Hope you enjoyed the show. And the models will be walking around if anybody wants to ask any questions. Thank you.
Okay. They look fabulous. Lovely outfits. Thank you very, very, very much. I'd like to invite, you would have heard him in the beginning of tonight. I'd like to invite Kadialy, please, back out here. At this point, camden.org, you can go. Everything that's being shown here, you can see there. As I say, this whole event is being live streamed. There's a bar there, there are drinks there. We're going to enjoy, we're going to listen, we're going to relax and listen to Kadialy. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Sigini babi nara jali nara jali nara amambo kuyatila jali tara jali mambo kuyatila na jali nara amambo kuyatila jali tara jali mambo kuyatila Kumbe kuyati majali felena Aluma yena kuyati na museyata Jaliyati rame malo Memba kuyati otu wevo jabiri inimu Memba kuyati o sarau jabiri lewa Thank you. Isi fangi kani fangwara yi fangi makunde. Pamari mari 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 Teriye panji Isi panji kani fawri panji makunde Mari 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 Hanna sikke din dileti Hanna sikke ke baleti o Hanna sikke musuleti Lanjuru toveti makunde Mbambururu Iye panji Isi panji Fangi, dindi isi fangi. Aye fangi, isi fangi. Iye fangi, kiba isi fangi. Bambari bari 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 Can you dem see your number again? Can you dem see your new gem? Adamadenu adame kisila. Oh, setanima alamisula. Kanubada alamisula. Nyanaliyo nyanal jamu yagufi. Fuamu jamu magildu faneko yai. Ngakairo duwa fo. Kairo siname ijantu. Kairo te dami kano titar lajitu.
Marolo jambe di lena
marolo jambe dile sani mane lu jambe dile na
Hello, sir. I'm going to pull up a chair and just say hello to you. Please, this gentleman has prayed as you've gone to the toilet, as you've got food, as you've got drink, as you've had your conversation. Kadialy, well done. It's fantastic. Could just tell us a little bit about your instrument, please, sir.
So this is the Kora, West African Sub-Saharan harp lute. I mean by that Senegal, Mali, Gambia, Guinea. Those used to belong to a big empire called the Mandé Empire, dated back to the 13th century. So this instrument is the youngest of many others that we play as griot storytellers, prayer singers, oral historians. So history wasn't written down. So it was the role of my ancestors to tell the history of people, of the villages, of the African society.
So did you bring that to this country?
No, this one nowadays, you know how it is. Everybody is making them as a business model.
No, I accept that. But there's some instruments that take a little while before they play in the way that you want to play.
Yeah, well, this has developed technology-wise in terms of the tuning pegs. These are very modern. Traditionally, we use the skin around the neck and push up and down to tune. But nowadays, actually, it makes life a bit easier for us because everybody wants kora in a lot of variety of genre of music. And we find ourselves playing into hip-hop, into pop music, as well as traditional. So because we change key quite a lot, so it's easier to have a easier tuning system. So definitely this helps.
What's the nearest European instrument to that?
It's described as the West African harp lute.
Right.
It's between a harp and a lute. So you play with your...
You pull, you pluck, you flick. What do you do?
You pluck the strings.
You pluck.
Yes.
That's a pluck. Okay.
Okay. And they are open strings, so each string is a particular note. So you have to develop a technique, of improvisation, of skills, of speed.
No, improvisation. don't say you made it up.
No. But improvisation is a big part of it. But it's set improvisation sometimes.
Yes.
So you have a core.
Oh, so it's working within the parameters. Melody. Okay.
So within that, you develop it. There is a whole musical language.
How long would it take somebody, Kadialy, to learn how to play that properly?
I teach this instrument at SOAS University.
Yes.
So therefore, there are students who've been learning the instrument for their undergrad. So by the end of that, they managed to play some stuff. But of course, there is a whole thing about the language, that you have to be born into it, as we say. The word griot is basically a Western word.
Yes.
We call ourselves jelly, which means that it's in your blood. You are born to be. There is a whole civilization, a whole culture that goes with that. It's not about just playing. So you translate that into the playing. So that's why when you're doing it, there is this thing we call hinno, which is the emotion that goes into the playing and the emotion that comes out and for the listener to hear. So you can still learn it, but for somebody who knows the culture, when
you have to feel it.
There is a big element of that. Yeah,
definitely. Okay. And you say you teach at the SOAS?
Yes. Yeah.
But you have a special event coming up for and behalf of Camden, don't you?
Yes, of course, yeah. I have a workshop to follow this performance, which is on the 16th of November.
You're not going to let some of the people here just pick your instrument up and play, are you? Because it won't be the same. When you say you have a workshop, what do you mean you show them what they could do if they could feel it like you, or you let them play it?
Nowadays, because, we are ready to open, the knowledge to anybody who is interested in it. Leopold Seda Senghor, who used to be the first president of Senegal, he talks about this thing which is like being rooted and open to the you know, the values of the world, also sharing your, you know, culture, sharing your values as well. So we are in that kind of journey.
So you're on that journey of sharing with everybody else.
And then, you know, but we have to be rooted in our own culture first.
Right, so where and when? Where and when will it be, the workshop?
The workshop going to be on the 16th of November in Holborn Library, I believe.
Yes, at Holborn Library.
Yeah, at Holborn
so
Library.
If anybody wants to come along...
If anybody wants to come, you can come and experience and learn more about this instrument and the culture that I come from.
Brilliant. I think you've been fantastic. Thank you very much
Thank you.
Playing it for us.
Kadialy,
big round of applause. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. Yeah, I mean, we've been literally talking over there about different types of black, because quite often when you come from the place that I come from as a kid, born of Caribbean parents, if I'm honest with you, Africa was not it when I was a kid, and it was a pejorative, and it was taking the mickey, and somehow in my lifetime now, you're happy. Everybody wants to give their children an African name. So quite often when people say to me, has there been progress? I go, yeah, it's, you know, looking at people and calling them Kunta or whatever it was when I was a kid to where it is now. There is progress as we live together, grow together and learn together. I just want to have some words with, actually, Lewis. I wasn't calling you Lewis there, but that's the way you spell it. Lewis, if you come back up for me, Sandra, if you come back up for me, and is our departing CEO. Are you there? Hello, Nats. Can you come back up for me, please? Swiss is going to join us. Swiss is architect of something called the Black Pound. We'll possibly talk about him and it before he comes. He's on his way, I'm told. I've got to tell you this, though, before we... you all right? You're the only one here with trousers tighter than me. Okay, right. As long as you're all right. One of the things that really did come from George Floyd, just to tell you a little bit about my home, is that after that, I found myself looking for black shops. After that, I found myself looking for people like me. And it's a very strange thing, because before that, everything that I'd ever done was based on price. So wherever you could get it better or cheaper, that's where I would go. But of course, if somebody's got a corner shop down there, they can't compete with one of the supermarkets. And actually, when I went into an Indian restaurant, I usually saw Indian people serving in the restaurant. And I don't mean this as a negative. I mean this as a statement of fact to what I saw in my life. When I went into a Chinese restaurant, most of the people who served me in that restaurant were Chinese. And when I went into a Caribbean restaurant, anybody could serve me. And it was really interesting because I never understood what was going on. And I think, though some people have it as a negative, honestly, I've had really long and difficult debates with people who think it's a form of prejudice to say black pound or whatever it might be. I think we're the only people who have ever had to be told to buy a shop from somebody who looks like you. Everybody else does it. Everybody else does it as a matter of course. You don't even think about it. It's so weird. And let me just ask you first, because you're the most troublemaking one on the panel, Sandra. Is anything I said there offensive? Because some people in some places might take it offensive. But it is a strange thing, isn't it? It's a strange phenomenon. And it didn't appear to me to exist in America.
No. What you're saying is not strange at all. The issues I have around... So one of the things I did over Christmas was I went into my high street store, cards galore. Yeah, I'm putting them out there. And I went to try and find a Christmas card. I could not find one single Christmas card in my high street cards galore that depicted a black family. It's like, what? You have 10,000 plus cards in here, not one family of people of color anywhere in this place. And you know, me and the owner, we had it was some uncomfortable conversations for a good hour. We have a section.
An hour?
Yeah, it was an hour.
We have a section now, still work in progress. But I say that to say, we have to hold up our communities too. We need to see more things in stores that look like us. We need more shops that sell things, black products for black people, for people of color in our shops. That's really, really important. And we don't have enough of that. There's not enough of that. I don't wanna have to go to an everyday shop. I wanna buy from black makers. That's where I want to spend my pound.
Okay.
That's why Black Pound is so important.
Okay, so normally people would wait to be announced, and they'd wait for me to introduce them. That's the way that we work it here, bro. I don't know how you do it. You just come in late and just walk up on the stage. Brother man, this is my house. You understand that? All right? Don't let me forget where I am, all right? Thank you. All right. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Swiss.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone.
It's a very particular sense of humour, you know, and I often get in trouble for it. We've been talking about you or it, and we're talking about the Black Power. Now, you instrumental, formerly of So Solid, entrepreneur.
Still So Solid, not formerly.
Yeah?
Yeah, still there. I'm DJing tomorrow as a So Solid DJ.
The police are giving you that 969 to DJ. Sorry, that's a ninja.
We're not banned.
That's a ninja. I apologize.
We're not banned anymore. We're functioning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So before Romeo done or anything like that, let's talk about what's this thing all about? What's the Black Pan? Because that's where we were going, and it's such an interesting thing where you buy things, who you hold to account, why it's necessary. Where did the idea come from?
It just came from being tired of marching. There's an elder that I listened to once, and he said, all you get out of marching is like thick calves. And, after we take our fists out of the air, I wanted us to put those fists in our pockets and support black businesses, because it's a more long-term sustainable way for change as opposed to marching.
Why, and here's where we got to, and I'm about to bring Nats and Lewis in, because this is how we're going to roll it now, right? Why is it necessary to call upon black people to buy from other black people? Surely that's what everybody should be doing anyway. Why is that necessary?
It should be, but we're just consumers. We're one of the biggest consumers in the country, on the planet, and we need to start taking ownership of what we produce. And so I saw an article in The Voice that said the Black Pound is worth, it was from a study, they said the Black Pound is worth 300 billion per year. That's the value of our pound. Now we have to ask ourselves, where is that 300 billion going? And if we can redirect that 300 billion into our community, then you'll see crime just dip straight away. And we'll be able to have more functional ways of acting and operating as a community. So it's a mindset shift. Black Pound Day is a mindset shift. Now before people shop, because of that first Saturday of every month and that awareness cause, when people shop now, they're thinking, where can I go and shop black first? And that's the biggest kind of achievement around the initiative of Black Pound Day, shifting the mindset of our community.
Yeah, I think it was a similar survey to that Swiss that said it was in America, and it looked at how long the white American pound stayed in the community, how long the Hispanic American, sorry, dollar, stayed in the community, and the African American pound was the one that dissipated most quickly.
Literally 6 hours, I think it was.
Yeah. So I know that. What was the initial reaction? Because I get now that people are doing it, and God bless Camden for saying, look, it is something that makes sense and it's something that we're buying into, not just for the season, but it's something that they're clearly buying into. What was the initial reaction?
It was pretty good. I think people were looking for something to allow themselves to continue the protest. And then we had the advent of the Black Square, which was taking a day out of social media, which I liked. It was cool, but it wasn't impactful enough to my, in my opinion. And big up the two sisters that started it. I forget their names now. But it was more of a music industry thing. And so we needed something that was more general for the public to engage with and redirect our energy through. And so the initial response was pretty great to me. I tried to reach out to the influencers and music artists that were influential in the same way that, clothing brands or big corporations use them. I was trying to use them for this community cause, and it pretty much worked.
We're in a really strange place now, because on another show or platform, we talk about this cancel culture, which is really freaky at the minute. But we're going to have a chat for 10 minutes. Now, if at any point in the next 10 minutes or so, there's a burning question for anybody on our panel, then I'll take it. So I do that. Lewis, what's changed for you in the aftermath of the killing of George Floyd? Your understanding, your perception, the way you carry yourself and the way you project yourself.
As an individual or what I'm observing?
Let's do individual first.
I think for me, I've had an opportunity to really consider how I take up space. And what I mean by that is really consider, in an environment, am I here solely in order to be able to play a role, or do I have a role to play? And because obviously they're different, right? Am I playing the role of being an individual who so happens to be from the Black community to provide a given perspective, or am I here to actually play my role of being able to help people to understand how the murder of George Floyd was allowed to happen? And more importantly, not just the fact that he was murdered, but the fact that there were officers that were there that watched it happen. There were also other citizens that were there that watched it happen. And what that therefore means for the way in which society has been allowed to function. And so for me as an individual, I think it's been weird because I don't think it's created any extra pressure, honestly. I think it's actually created a little bit more liberation to say, do you know what, I'm going to speak a bit more unapologetically.
Absolutely.
Do you know what I mean? Even down to the work I do, like a lot of people will be like, right, when we come on Lewis's things, he's always playing music and this, and I'm like, yeah, this is what we do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, mine, I don't bust a soak on here soon.
I wore my No Blacks, No Irish, No Dogs t-shirt to the BBC. Mm. I would never have worn that pre-George Floyd. So I think the reason I'm asking these questions and for members of the audience is to just see how psychologically that image and somebody calling for their mother who'd already died has impacted on all of us. Now, let me ask you a question, and I've saved the difficult one for you because you're leaving. So here's the thing, here's the conversation I've been having at work, and if I'm honest with you, with a lot of the white people that I know I've been having, which is, bloody hell, I didn't know. Because that freedom that Lewis is talking about, that spending that Swiss is talking about, and that I'm going to stand in your shop for an hour telling you why you need to have a card, wasn't happening before. So many of us were fitting in, staying quiet, being part of it, but not imposing ourselves, showing our personality, that many of the people to whom we are now speaking didn't know. Have you encountered any of that?
I think I'm trying to channel Sabrina's authenticity. I think, honestly speaking, the day after it happened was probably like one of the hardest days. Like the day after, you know, it came out, and I think there was a lot of soul search and a lot of reflecting. And I think you're 100% right. And I think even me, I mean, I have light skin privilege, you know, and I've always been aware of it, but you just don't say things out loud. You don't fit with here, you don't fit there. You know it, and you try your best, but you don't say it out loud. And what happened, I think, with the George Floyd thing is that someone went and said it.
And that's what it felt like, isn't it?
And then there was no going back. Like, someone said it now, so it's real now for everyone, and you're just gonna have, we are all, not just white people, like, we are all going to have to deal with the consequences of it, because that thing that we've been kind of not saying and hiding behind in polite society, and you know, it's kind of like it was stealth, wasn't it? It was there, we all knew it was there, everyone knew. I mean, let's think about it. I'm here supported by my big cousin, Nat. She's not big at all, she's only like 1 year older than me, but she'll always be my big cousin because she was the one that had to come around my hair. Do you know what I mean? She was the one that had to look after me. And I knew from a young age that I did not have the privileges that my white family had. I didn't have them, You know, they had that sense of entitlement there. There was other things that they had that they weren't aware of that I knew I had to fit in. I used to be the au pair at the school gates. Other parents used to come and ask me to look after their kids because they didn't realize that's my sister, that's my brother, because I was the brown one, you know? So I was obviously hired, right? But at the same time, I could see privileges that I had that my cousin didn't have. So I've dedicated my entire career to leveling those privileges.
I get that. Because that's your life. What I'm asking.
But that made me question. That's why I didn't know that was my life. I didn't know why I was doing this until that day. The morning after, I got up and I thought, this is why I'm doing what I'm doing, because of that big lie thing. You know? That's what I mean. Like the blinkers came off.
No, I understand that. I understand. I mean, I've met so many women who said to me, in the wake of what happened with Bieber and Nicole and what happened with Sarah, I didn't realize that I crossed the road. I didn't realize that I don't go. I didn't realize that I have my key in my hand. I didn't realize that I always tell someone. And all the behavior that you adopt and you take on and you think is part of your normal. And when something happens, it makes you go, bloody hell. And I think that's the moment we're in. It's quite a scary time, you know, because there's a lot happening. Swiss, I once was blessed to go and give a speech somewhere, and then the CEO followed me and he said this thing, and I'd like to ask you what you think about it. He said, diversity is allowing black people into a place, inclusion is allowing them to dance. That makes sense to you? Because you could get in a job, but if you're like my mum, hold it down. Don't sing too loud, don't wear too bright clothes, don't speak in an accent, keep it.
Yeah.
Are you dancing?
Am I dancing? I'm dancing to my own drum.
Yeah, man. But then kind of, as an entrepreneur, self-employed person, you've been dancing all along, right?
Define that again for me. What do you mean by dancing?
So diversity is allowing people in. Let's say we have an organization and we're 500 people and we have 10 black people work there. That's diversity. So they're
trying
in
to
there,
make it more diverse,
they're whatever. Yeah. Inclusion is where those people feel they can bring themselves, their food, their culture, their ideas, their individuality, their experiences to the table to help to create a better, fairer environment. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense, yeah. I'm trying to make, our culture more accessible by coming into those spaces and, you know, making it okay to be ourselves. We're working with corporations at the moment as Black Pound Day, and just trying to collate lists of businesses that can work within organizations, provide services or products for those organizations, whereby these businesses can feel like themselves when they're in those spaces. And so I feel like inclusion is very important. And it's something that we have to create for ourselves.
I mean, much of this is important in terms of where we are. It's great to work with people, but actually it's got to come from within, isn't it? I mean, I'm asking you, queen, disruptor, head rapper, American, Haitian.
Well, it depends. You know, I don't always toe the line, so... I think...
Yeah, but what is the line? I don't understand. When you say that, I don't know what you
mean.
I feel
like there's a line. There's always a line. I think we kind of know what the line is. But I think if we want to... I've always been loud. It's not like I just became loud overnight. I've always been loud. So I've always been the one...
But you're allowed to because you're American.
Maybe. And that's what I've been told. It's like, you got an American accent, so you could get away with this.
If you look at the reality programs that we have over here, I challenge you. And you look at when they bring over Huggy Bear or they bring over Jermaine Jackson or they bring over Americans. You know, ain't we got enough has-beens as well? So you're allowed to be loud, expressive, because we expect that from you.
Maybe. Well, I might as well take advantage of it, right? So I am going to take advantage of that. I am going to be loud. I am going to be the loudest person in the room. So don't invite me unless you really want me to be loud. That's what I'm saying. So I definitely want to be able, but I want to empower other people. And the thing, me and Lewis, we talk about this all the time. Everything that we do, we don't do it for us. Everything Swiss is doing is not for him. Everything you're doing is not for you. What we do is for the people who are coming after us. Everything that we do comes 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years later. We're not gonna notice any of this stuff right now. The stats say we're not going to notice any of the big differences that we want to see until 2046. I might not be here in 2046, okay? I mean, if I am, I hope to be on some Caribbean island eating plantain and drinking, you know. But I say this to say the work is the work and the work is the work now. We can't wait. And the thing about what happened to the murder of George Floyd has given us a real platform. And it's a real platform for us to create change, right?
Everybody.
All of us. White people, black people, everybody.
Particularly Camden.
Everybody. Everybody. I see what you're doing.
Yeah, I know.
Everybody.
I'm sorry, it's too obvious.
Okay? Everybody has a job to do in the space. And don't always wait for the person of color to do the work.
What?
Please, you could do the work too. Don't wait for me to say something. You can see the obvious stuff that's happening in the room too. Speak up. Use your voice in those spaces.
Yes, you're right. You're always right. You are right. You are. But I just tell you that having done it, speaking truth to power is not easy.
It's not easy.
And when we talk about whistleblowers, you know, even at the BBC with Princess Diana, there was a guy who was, you know, a graphic designer. Those guys knew about what Cousins was doing. So I hope that from our conversation today, we have other conversations which can give courage to people to speak. Swiss, I'm going to let you have the last word today. What is it? You're here. It's a Black History season. We're in Camden. They want to hear what you're going to say. You got all the topper people here today. Yeah. You know, the person who's in charge of London councils, the chief executive, the next person to the chief executive.
Pressure.
Yeah. No, there's no pressure because you're dancing.
Yeah, I am. Dancing to our own beat. So I've just come from a full day shift from our store in Westfield, which is the biggest shopping center in Europe, and we have a Black Pound Day store there. So I want everyone to come down and support 70 plus UK black owned businesses showcasing their work, their value, their product, and come and spend your money. Pardon? Westfield Shepherd's Bush, the bougie one.
That's not the biggest one, brother, man.
Yeah, it's the biggest one.
What are you talking about? It's the biggest one in West London.
No, it's the biggest shopping.
Who cares? We're going to go down there. We're going.
Exactly. We're going down there. It doesn't matter how big it is. Yeah, it's important. It's important, yeah. No, it's the biggest shopping centre in a city in Europe. So, you know, we launched that on the 2nd of October, Black Pound Day, and we're there up until, I'm not supposed to say this because I didn't want to put a limit on it and tell people the end date because they won't come until the end.
Then don't.
I won't say it then. Yeah, just come down.
But they're now, right? They're there now.
Yeah, we're here now.
It might done tomorrow, isn't it?
Exactly. It might finish tomorrow.
In fact, just go and sleep there now.
There you go. Yeah, so I want people to come down and spend with us because we've done something historical down there. And as the sister said, you know, sometimes we're fighting for 3, 4, 5 generations down. So when Martin Luther King pivoted and he started to talk about economics as opposed to marching, it's the same thing I'm trying to talk about now, you know. And I feel like with the Spend Black movement in America, it's just coming to fruition what he was saying towards the end of his untimely demise.
It sounds like I'm in one of my sessions, but I genuinely believe something I learned a few years ago, which is that there's only two limiting beliefs we have in life. We don't think we deserve it, or we don't expect it.
Yeah.
And I was speaking to some people over there in the break who said the way you articulated what you said when me and you were speaking earlier, Eddie, about the fact that, you know, I have now got to a point in my life where I unapologetically say, no, the reason I produce results is not because of my charisma, it's because of the fact that this is strategy, this is intelligence, this is whatever. And they were saying, wow, why don't I carry myself like that? And I'm sitting there listening, I'm saying, it's because you don't believe you deserve it or you don't expect it. You need to expect it now. Like, I expect that whatever I do, the work I do with Revolution Hive, 7PK, Eva Business, something's changing today. That transformation is happening. And yeah, we're going to wait for the real results in the future. But try and know today, a seed's getting planted, a fire's getting started, something happening. Do you know what I mean? And that comes from what you just said, Nat, in terms of the expectation is so high.
To.
Do you know what I mean?
Don't just open the door. Give me a seat at your desk.
100%. When I go to a school, I tell the students in their school, in front of the head teacher in the assembly, this is my school now. That's what I say.
So we're all going to dance, Eddie, for you.
We're all going to dance.
Wonderful. Listen, it's fantastic to meet all of you. as creatives, as inspirers, as leaders, I hope that we can continue this conversation, because it is one, and hopefully what we've done today is not just done all the easy stuff. Some of the conversation has been quite challenging as well, and I do honestly hope that in whatever field we're in, we continue to do that. So Swiss, keep selling, brother, and keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
Really proud of what you're trying to do with the Black Pound Day.
Thank you.
Nats, whatever you go off to, I hope you are
hopefully
a success.
Hopefully down that step in one
well,
place.
Yeah, we're
going to... It was actually my shoes,
no,
not my jeans,
I know. Sorry. Your shoes are too tight then, sorry. And thank, lovely to meet you,
Lewis.
And to you, I might try one of those head wraps then. Listen, it's lovely to meet you all, as I say, and all the other creatives in the room, and all the people for facilitating something like this in a space I didn't really even know you had here. Come visit Camden. I think it's at lovecamden.org. I think that's where it is. Nikki will tell me off if it isn't there. Please travel home safely where you go. And one of the things we say, you can be who you want to be, do what you want to do. The only limits to what you can achieve are the limits of your own imagination. Be the best that you can. God bless you, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you, Nikki.
Thank you, Eddie.
Thank you, Eddie.